Hi, I'm Barbara Bolton. I'm a Scottish solicitor. My practice day-to-day is in civil litigation and dispute resolution, and I practice in Scotland, but I'm also qualified in England and Wales. And in a former life, I was a lawyer in New York for a wee period of time. And away from my work, as you heard, I'm involved in vegan advocacy as a volunteer. And I do that through a group that I co-founded with my sister and some other core volunteers, Go Vegan Scotland. We have a vegan information stall here today, actually, which you might have seen, and it's here primarily for the plant-based conference that's happening next door, because many of the people attending that are probably not yet vegan, so they're good people for us to be speaking to. just going to note the time. So, given this, the theme of this year's conference, I am going to talk about the access to plant-based food for vegans in this country, in Scotland. But firstly, I wanted to take the opportunity to put it into a bit of context. So, you know, if we step back from this event and think about what it is we're trying to achieve, this is really one instance of a coming together of a group of people, group of vegans who share certain skills and are thinking about, well, how can we use our particular skills to try and advance veganism and animal rights, which in my mind are one and the same thing. And when we go vegan, I think that's one of the questions many of us ask ourselves. What's the best use of my time, given my skill set, for my contribution to animal liberation? And people can contribute to this social justice movement in many ways, using whatever skills they have, whether it's music, writing, social media skills, project management, or whatever. And in this room, many of us share legal skills. And there are very few vegan lawyers, and there are even fewer who practice. And so many of us feel a responsibility to use our skills to do what we can to advance the rights of other animals. And I think the obvious answer might appear to be animal law. But when we think about that, what is animal law from a vegan perspective? As vegans, we've rejected animal use, exploitation, and killing. We have rejected the idea that animals are our property. We've rejected the idea that there is a good way to use and kill other animals. If we hadn't rejected that, we wouldn't be vegan. And as Tom Reagan said, we don't want bigger cages, we want empty cages. And as Gary Francione's pointed out, for as long as animals are our property under the law, they will never have rights in the true sense of that word. An item of property cannot simultaneously be the holder of rights. They might be given certain protections in the interests of their owners, of those who use them, of those who benefit from their use, but their interests will never win when set against our wants. So as vegan lawyers, are we going to dismantle the property status of animals using legal challenge? Well, our government is made up of non-vegans. Our parliament consists of non-vegans, with very few exceptions. Our lawyers and judges are almost all non-vegan. Our business community, which influences government policy, pretty much all non-vegan. And critically, the people who vote for government policy, almost all non-vegan. And while our laws are drafted, approved, and applied by non-vegans, I think we would be very naive to think that the law can do anything other than reinforce speciesism, regulating and enforcing our use and killing of other animals. This is a useful quote from Gary Francione, who is actually here paraphrasing his partner, Anna Charlton, and they're both vegan law professors at Rutgers University in New Jersey. The legal system will never respond differently to animal issues unless and until there's a significant shift in prevailing social consensus about animal exploitation. The law reflects social attitudes and does not form them. As long as people think it's fine to eat animals, to use them in experiments, to use them for entertainment, the law is not likely to be a particularly helpful tool for animals. At this point, the job of an animal rights lawyer is not to be the primary force for change within the system, as lawyers were part of a system that exists to protect property interests. A useful animal rights lawyer is a criminal lawyer one day, helping activists charged with civil disobedience, an administrative lawyer the next, helping activists obtain permits, and a constitutional lawyer the next, helping students who don't want to vivisect and helping prisoners who need access to vegan food. And that is how I see it. The law is not going to be at the forefront of this movement, not at this point in time. We're not going to persuade a government made up of non-vegans to ban slaughterhouses, while the vast majority of people think it's perfectly acceptable to kill and eat other animals and use them for food and clothing. The law follows societal change, and once a sufficient number of us have rejected using other animals as our tools, have rejected treating them as unfeeling things instead of the feeling living beings that they are, then the law will catch up. And then there will be an interesting discussion for all of us to have about just what legislation ought to say. So for example, that no animal can be the property of a human, or that it's unlawful to breed, use, or kill another animal for any purpose. And also, for example, do we need to say anything in particular about wild animals? They'll all be very interesting questions, and maybe it's worth spending a little bit of time on that now so that we're putting something concrete up there for what we're saying we're striving for. But until we have a sufficient number of us who've rejected animal use and killing, we're not going to see fundamental legal change. So, as I see it, veganism comes first, then the legal recognition of animal rights. And so vegan advocacy comes first and foremost. And some people might disagree, and they might say, well, there are already laws that protect animals. And while we are in a non-vegan world, we should be working to enforce those protections. There is no law of animal rights. There's only the regulation of the use and killing, otherwise known as animal welfare law. And these laws were introduced to Britain from as early as the year 1800. So prior to that, it appears that the use and killing of animals was unregulated on the basis that animals were considered inferior to humans, perhaps even considered automatons, unthinking, unfeeling machines, which is a view often attributed to Descartes. Prior to that, of course, there were leading thinkers who rejected the idea that animals were things, such as Da Vinci, a long time prior to that. But as a general matter, that's how people saw animals. And then in the 19th century, people began to accept that animals do feel. And we have the famous quote from Jeremy Bentham: "The question is not can they reason, nor can they talk, but can they suffer?" But although there was acceptance that animals feel, Bentham and others said that they were not self-aware and that they didn't have any interest in continuing to live. And so our human interest in using and killing them took precedence. It was acceptable to use them and kill them. We just needed to consider their suffering when we were doing that. That was Bentham's view in the early 1800s, and that remains the basis of our welfare laws today. This is the leading text on animal welfare law in Britain. Mike Radford, the author, recognises that animal welfare law is premised on the central idea that it's morally acceptable to use and kill other animals. We just have to do that humanely. Well, what does that mean? Well, as in the early 1800s, it means that we should avoid inflicting unnecessary suffering. Well, maybe that sounds good, but what does it mean? Well, death is not sufficient. The infliction of extreme pain is not in itself enough. It's lawful to inflict pain as long as that's necessary. The standard also doesn't require that we inflict the least amount of pain or suffering. The relevant test is that an animal is not caused to suffer unnecessarily by the standards of the legislatively sanctioned practice which has been adopted. Basically, if the practice is deemed necessary to the overall objective of using animals for food, clothing, entertainment, whatever, then the suffering inflicted is permissible. And Radford recognises, therefore, that there's force in what Guy Francione says when he critiques welfare laws, that this standard of unnecessary suffering doesn't actually introduce any sort of objective moral principle. And of course, most people think that's exactly what it does. And the animal use industries, and in fact so-called animal charities, encourage people to believe that. In fact, welfare regulations help the animal use industries. People who have the impulse to do something because they know that there is a moral issue, that we're using and killing living beings. Instead of responding to that by they reach out for higher welfare labels. And we meet those people on our stalls through Go Vegan Scotland every week. To put the point in Guy Francione's own words from a slideshow on his website, abolitionistapproach.com, we only ask whether the particular treatment is necessary given the ways we want to use animals. Basically, unnecessary suffering is whatever we say it is, we being those in power in terms of our lawmaking. What we end up with are laws like these, which set out the granular detail as to just how we can use, exploit, and kill other animals. And there's many examples of this. This particular one sets out our rules on controlling and exploiting calves, consigning calves for rearing and fattening, just how many weeks can we keep them in isolated confinement, and just how small can we make their cages. The very existence of these laws is morally repugnant. It's been over 200 years since people began to accept that animals feel, and yet we exploit and kill them in their billions, in vastly greater numbers than we did back then. Perhaps if we had not had animal welfare law, we would have seen that we needed to stop using other living beings as if they're things. So like most people, when I went vegan, I wanted to do everything I could to help. I supported every organization connected with animals. I signed copious amounts of petitions, chaired all the single issue campaigns, and I thought that I could and should promote veganism alongside welfare regulation. And it was listening to and reading the work of Guy Francione and Anna Charlton and others that helped me to realize that one really contradicts the other. That in promoting welfareism, I was undermining veganism and thereby animal rights. That welfare regulations act as a blocker to people going vegan. And if I wanted to do the best I could for other animals, I should be advocating for veganism clearly and consistently and nothing less. And that's really what led to us setting up the volunteer advocacy group, Go Vegan Scotland. Similarly, I learned from their work in terms of thinking about what I should do with my skills to help other animals. And I realised that we're never going to achieve animal liberation by working within a system that regulates and thereby legitimises animal use and killing. And I realised that working in animal welfare made no sense. It was actually inimical to the interests of other animals. And it's not as if it's a case that if vegan lawyers don't do it, no one else will. There's no shortage of non-vegan lawyers who are very willing to take on animal welfare cases. And in fact, most of the lawyers, for example, who work on SSPCA, RSPCA cases are non-vegan. And they will be eating bits of the bodies of dead animals while working on these cases and seeing no contradiction in their behavior. Vegans are the only ones who will challenge them to consider the contradiction. No one else can, because if you're non-vegan, you're participating in exploitation and killing. So I think that those of us who can advocate for veganism should, and obviously that's not only applicable to lawyers, but the point being that when we think about our skills as lawyers, I think we should go further than just our pure legal skills. When people think of lawyers, they often think of people who are able at presenting coherent logical arguments. Lawyers can be very good at taking vast amounts of information and distilling it down into the key points, at delivering persuasive arguments, at foreseeing the rebuttal arguments and effectively countering them. And for practicing lawyers will also have developed a range of skills that we perhaps don't even think of as skills. So project management, teamwork, delegation, meeting deadlines, event planning, administration, dealing with difficult people, managing our own stress. And all of these skills can be invaluable to a social justice movement. Perhaps the key skill I can think of is simply making things happen. And I think those of us who don't realize that that is actually a skill in itself, that you need to have focus, drive, and determination. And not everyone has the skill. Obviously, again, it's not only lawyers who have these skills, but I think we should be thinking more broadly than pure legal knowledge. In terms of the law, though, one thing I think we can do that uses our legal skills without undermining our advocacy is promoting animal liberation through vegan rights. So in doing that, we can't call ourselves animal lawyers, and it perhaps doesn't have the same kudos or social media eye-catching status, but we will be doing essential work, and we won't be supporting an immoral system that's built on speciesism. Which brings us to vegan rights. I'm not going to go into detail about the rights we have, because that was covered this morning, and I've also given presentations on it previously, one of which was recorded and is on our Go Vegan Scotland YouTube channel. It's about 20, 25 minutes long, I think, and just gives an overview of the main rights of vegans in the UK. We also have a book that Jeanette Rowley and I have just published, Vegan Rights in the UK, Promoting Animal Liberation Using Vegan Rights, and that sets out in detail the rights of vegans in the UK, the rights that apply within Europe, and to some extent internationally. And the next part of my presentation is to say that we have hard copies here today, but unfortunately we don't. There was an issue with the delivery, but it will be available to order from the Go Vegan Scotland website under our support store. So you can see from the cover that even although the topic is the human rights of vegans, the focus is on other animals. And that was absolutely critical, and it's discussed in the introduction to the book. With some of the situations that vegans face, they are really dreadful, and they warrant rights-based claims in their own right. But vegans as a group are not a persecuted minority. We don't endure exploitation, violence, and death as a consequence of our veganism. It's non-human animals who are subjugated, exploited, and killed in their billions due to their status as non-humans. And we're vegan because we recognize their rights. So when we're prevented from living vegan, it's their rights we're being forced to breach. So when we enforce the rights of vegans, we're seeking to protect not only the vegan themselves, but more importantly, the non-human animals they are trying to avoid exploiting and killing. So while acting for vegans, for other humans, might not have the same kudos as being an animal lawyer, in reality we are acting for animals, as we're defending the rights of vegans in order that they can live in the recognition of other animals' rights. So, briefly, what are vegan rights? We've heard about it in detail this morning. In the EU, and to some extent internationally, we have the right to live according to our fundamental ethical convictions, when they're considered worthy of respect in a democratic society and don't conflict with the rights of others. And veganism has been recognised as such, so we have the right to live according to our fundamental conviction that it is wrong to use and kill other animals unnecessarily. Just as someone who holds religious beliefs has the right to live in accordance with those beliefs. It's not an absolute right, but restrictions have to be necessary for public health, safety, or morals, and they have to be proportionate. And the state has a positive duty to secure to us our right to act in accordance with our fundamental convictions. They've got to take such steps as are necessary and pass such laws as are needed to do so. And then separately, we have the right not to be discriminated against on account of our vegan convictions. And in the EU, that right applies in the employment context, but in the UK, it applies essentially everywhere, in both the public and the private sphere. Both direct and indirect discrimination are prohibited, meaning that if an apparently neutral policy or practice has a negative impact on someone because they're vegan, it would be open to challenge unless they were able to show that the policy was necessary and proportionate. So to put it simply, if you can think of a scenario in which somebody who holds a religious belief ought to be accommodated, then vegan beliefs probably should be too. So last year, through Go Vegan Scotland, I carried out a survey to find out what the position was for vegans in Scotland's state entities. And the survey showed that vegans are being discriminated against in Scotland's schools, hospitals, and other public institutions. Among the responses, vegan hospital patients gave examples of being denied access to suitable food, being force-fed animal products against their convictions, people recovering from serious operations or having just given birth, unable to eat because there was no suitable food, and either having to go for days without eating in hospital or discharging themselves early because they had no other option. Relying on food brought by family or friends, and in some cases being refused permission to bring that food onto the ward. Being put under pressure to consume animal products and being subjected to derogatory comments or inaccurate nutritional information, which amounts to usually the same thing, where they're putting pressure on you to consume animals. Vegan parents or pupils in schools gave examples of children missing out on free school meals because there were no suitable options. Some schools actually said, we do not provide food for vegans. Teaching staff mocking the ethics of pupils, bias in our teaching in favour of speciesism and animal use, and children being refused the opportunity to use alternatives in cooking classes. Vegan state employees gave examples of staff avoiding meetings and training sessions because there would be no options for them, and being belittled when they asked in the canteen about suitable options. And also issues in relation to the military and police in certain situations where there are no options. And those are just the food-related matters because of today's topic. But other very important issues were raised, including, for example, unemployed vegans being told they would have to apply for a job in a slaughterhouse or they would not get their benefits, children required to participate in dissection or wear animal skins or be pressured to attend places where animals are imprisoned. So we published the results of the survey in March this year, and we brought it to the attention of the Scottish Equalities and Human Rights Commission, and also the Scottish Government and relevant ministers. And we called on the Scottish Government to take certain steps, including ensure that there are good, suitable for vegans options on all state entity menus every day, and to also educate public sector workers in what veganism actually is and its protected status, and also to promote plant-based nutrition education for medical professionals and in our schools. So our full submissions are on our website on the Living Vegan section of the page. So that was in March. So on the 23rd of May, the Scottish Government responded and apparently acknowledge that veganism is a protected moral conviction, so that's positive. One of the most important things for us in making the submission was to be very clear about that, that veganism is not a diet, it's a way of living according to a protected moral conviction. And every aspect of vegan rights work, as I see it, is an opportunity for that advocacy. It gives us the perfect opportunity because we only have these rights because veganism is a moral conviction and not a diet. So when you talk about vegan rights, it's the perfect chance to explain why that is the case. The Scottish Government also noted that individual public authorities will be required to ensure they make reasonable adjustments for people with protected characteristics. They've already said that veganism is protected, so they apparently acknowledge that our public authorities should be providing for us. But then they distance themselves from their own obligations, saying, well, it's up to individual organisations to comply, and it's not within the gift of the Scottish Government to enforce them. Well, we've written back and we've pointed out, actually, it is the responsibility of the central government to take such steps and pass such laws as are necessary to secure to us our rights, and it's not good enough to say this is a local issue. And also, that is not the position the Scottish Government takes on any other human rights or equality matter, as far as I can see. But in terms of next steps, we will use freedom of information legislation to call for local authorities to provide us with documents that confirm what the options are that they make available to vegans currently in our schools, in our hospitals, in other state institutions. We'll also ask them to disclose their policies, if they exist, on training staff about what veganism is and how it's protected. And when we have that information, we'll analyse it and we'll publish a report, and then we'll use that to press them to comply with their obligations. And as we do with everything, we'll share that with Scottish vegans so that they can individually also be taking those steps. Through the process that we've undergone so far, it's come to our attention that at least one of our local authorities, the school caterers, so they provide to all of the schools in that region, they don't provide any plant-based meals that are suitable for vegans. And they say that that is because they understand veganism to be a special diet that requires NHS approval on a case-by-case basis. And that can't be right, because the NHS recognises that we can get everything we need on a well-planned plant-based diet. And in fact, the NHS this year in February recognised the connection between plant-based eating and diabetes prevention. And we know that there are many schools in Scotland who are providing good, vegan, suitable, plant-based meals. So there's a real lack of consistency, and there's clearly a lot to be done in terms of providing information and education. And it's the same position in our hospitals. So this mismatch between the understanding of school caterers and where things actually stand in terms of official recognition of the nutritional adequacy of a vegan diet raises the importance of this education and dissemination of vegan nutrition information. So hence the conference next door on plant-based nutrition for medical professionals. In our book on vegan rights, I make the distinction between veganism and a plant-based diet, and I say that that's not a matter of semantics, it's actually critical. And I think that's the case, because if you're talking about plant-based diet, out with the context of living vegan, then the animals are nowhere to be seen. And there's nothing wrong, obviously, with somebody adopting a plant-based diet for health, for the environment, for any other reason. And the increase in availability of plant-based options is really helpful for all of us. But there is a problem when that is confused with veganism, because veganism is a social justice movement on behalf of non-human animals, and it sits alongside other social justice movements for human issues. And if you dilute it down to just a diet, then you completely undermine that. And I think a lot of the situations that vegans are facing that I mentioned are at least in part because of that fundamental misunderstanding about what veganism is. Most people still think that veganism is a diet, that vegans are people who've chosen to adopt a restrictive diet or to treat their bodies as temples or whatever, rather than seeing it in a way as living in a way that recognises the rights of other animals. And I think every discussion about vegan rights is an opportunity to counter that. Once people understand that it's not simply a choice, a dietary choice, that it's actually living in terms of your moral conviction that it's wrong to kill other animals, more people, I was going to say most people, but at least more people will respect that and will do what they can to allow you to live in that way. As a vegan education group, Go Vegan Scotland's focus is always on that moral issue of our use and killing of other animals, and we're not going to water that down by confusing veganism with plant-based eating. But we can and do acknowledge the benefits of plant-based eating, which is a component part of living vegan. So we also recognise that the misinformation about plant-based nutrition is causing problems for vegans and also affecting vegan advocacy. And we can point out to the government that providing plant-based food would not only satisfy their duty to vegans, but it would be consistent with their other stated policy objectives on nutrition and health, on the environment, on sustainability. And we made those points, among others, in our submission to the Scottish Government's recent consultation on diet, health and weight. in that submission, we made it expressly clear our focus is on the injustice of what we're doing to other animals. But given the focus of the consultation, we then referred to the considerable volume of information that shows the health benefits of a plant-based diet. And we encouraged them to take steps such as promoting plant-based farming, provision and consumption, as well as education in terms of growing and preparing plant-based food. And again, the full submission is on our website under the Living Vegan section. And there are more consultations underway in Scotland or anticipated. So currently they're consulting on proposed amendments to the nutritional requirements for food and drink in schools. Obviously, a perfect opportunity to draw attention again to the nutritional adequacy of plant-based eating and the studies that show significant health benefits of plant-based eating. At the very least, they should be giving a guarantee of a plant-based option suitable for vegans on every menu, in every state institution, every day. But we can also refer to examples such as in Brazil, where, as I understand it, they now have fully plant-based school lunches, and we can encourage them to actually go further than that. We can also do that in the context of the much anticipated Good Food Nation consultation. So this is where the Scottish Government foresees bringing in framework legislation, which would cover all aspects of food rather than dealing with it piecemeal. Production, agricultural land use, planning law, the environment, sustainability, nutritional guidelines, health, education, food justice, food poverty, and so on. The framework should cover all of that, and it should bring it all together in one place. And it's also thought that the bill might include a right to food, although that remains to be seen. So Canada recently went through this process, and if Scotland follows, they'll be one of the first countries to do this. The consultation was supposed to start late last year, and then early this year, and it still hasn't started, and there's been no real sort of official pronouncement about why that is the case. But hopefully it will be launched soon, because clearly that's an excellent opportunity to encourage them to take all of the relevant steps that would promote a plant-based food industry. So as well as encouraging events like the conference next door and raising awareness of these issues, we can also consider making legal challenges. And the book that Jeanette and I have just published lays out the ground for that in terms of what our rights are and the possibilities of some of the challenges we might make. So for example, we could try to target some of the structural issues, such as the EU subsidies to animal use industries, or dairy's monopoly on certain words, which we're going to hear more about later, or speciesism in our school curriculum, or we could consider some test cases in terms of a failure to provide for vegans in our state institutions. I think there's a huge amount that potentially we could do, and what we need to do is give careful thought to how we use the limited time and resources we have to achieve the best results. So what I've outlined in terms of what we've done so far and what we aim to do, it has to be seen in the context of Go Vegan Scotland being a voluntary group. So we're not an organisation, we don't have any salaries, don't have any jobs. We've done what we've done so far on the basis of having volunteers who are prepared to spend their time away from their paying jobs to promote veganism. And the fact that we don't have jobs or salaries obviously affects how much time we're able to spend on it, as nobody's able to fully dedicate themselves to our projects. But as I see it, that's also our strength. Because when fundraising becomes a focus, when there's salaries and overheads to cover, then the aim of hitting that fundraising target can affect everything. Priorities, resource assignment, objectives. And you see that if you look at any of the big animal organisations, and I've seen it firsthand working with an animal welfare charity. If you've got salaries and overheads, the plea to prioritise certain campaigns and to frame them in a certain way that brings in more donations is really very hard to argue against, because you'll be met with, well, if we don't have enough money to pay our salaries and our overheads, we go under, we no longer exist. So the organisation kind of takes on a life of its own. We want to avoid that. We want to avoid any influences that may dilute the message or could possibly dilute the message down the line. And I think the only way to do that, aside from some windfall donation without any ties whatsoever, is to remain volunteers and do what we can in our own time. So that's why there's such an emphasis in the book on self-help, because we've written it with non-lawyers in mind, and we're aiming to get vegans the information they need so that they can themselves be doing this work, be advocating for better provision, be explaining to schools and hospitals and local authorities what veganism really is and the protections we have, but also why we have them. The more of us asking for respect for our moral conviction, and the more of us pushing for that with knowledge of our legal rights, the better. Because if we're to achieve widespread change, then all of us who can should be out there doing that. I think I'm going to leave it there. I was going to finish by saying we'd like a hard copy of our book come to our stall, but we don't have one yet. So, as I say, they're on our website, goveganscotland.com, under the support store. Thanks for listening. It's self-published, in the end it was a case of just get it out.
Yeah.
It's something that we've been working on for over a year, and I think I gave a talk in December saying it will be out in January, which was, you know, just never going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And going through a publishing process would take time. I think down the track we would like to do, you know, a properly published book. But on the other hand, we want it to be as accessible as possible.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is information that I think every vegan needs. And so, you know, if you go through the formal publishing process, I'm not familiar with it actually, but I assume that it has an impact on, you know, having to charge and so on. So, any other questions?
No, I do have just one more point that I actually kind of would like to get some feedback from the floor as well, maybe. I'm based in Ireland, and I'm just kind of curious about, you know, when you've got something coming from the European Convention on Human Rights, and it's interpreted in a particular way in one country, I'm not sure that shouldn't be copied. Do you know what I mean? Like, is it possible to interpret it in a whole host of different ways in different countries? Or is there not a principle of direct effect, or?
Yeah, so what would happen in any individual country is, if you were taking a challenge under the convention,
mm-hmm.
you would ultimately end up in the European Court of Human Rights having then decided, if need be. But firstly, you have to exhaust your local remedies. So you have to go all the way through your own national court system first. And as you say, one country's Supreme Court might interpret it differently than another country's highest court. But ultimately, if it was appealed all the way to the European Court of Human Rights, they would decide. And every country ought to be paying heed to decisions that have already been made in Europe and applying them.
Yeah.
But that doesn't necessarily mean that they do.
It's just like that initiative with the public broadcaster. They did a program on so-called veganism a few months ago.
Yeah.
And the thing is, the dairy industry is very big in Ireland, and it's been very hardly hit by a very sudden switch over to plant-based milk. And they're just failing to follow the market. So, like, one of the food bodies is saying, what can we do to win vegans and vegetarians back, you know? But anyway, they had this broadcast in which probably the best known chef said that she thought that cranky vegans, what they really needed was a steak. And I thought at that minute, well, you could not say that about a religious minority who was following a particular dietary restriction. So I lecture in law at the National University of Ireland in Galway. And so I wrote them a fairly long letter about the various protections, and their response was, well, this is just your interpretation of Article 9 of the Convention. And I'm there, well, no, it's not an interpretation. It's there
mm-hmm.
on the website of the COE. So, like, some of my my colleagues in the broader community went on and made a complaint to the Broadcasting Authority, but, I mean, it got nowhere. They say that they're just bound by the Broadcasting Act, which isn't true. Obviously, they're bound by other laws as well. But I'm just deciding, trying to decide on how to proceed, and probably I'll go with the, you know, the Equality and Human Rights Commission in
mm-hmm.
Ireland, because I think it's probably a better route than going through, you know.
Yeah.
So
I think with those kinds of situations, it probably falls more under the discrimination and harassment than it does under the right to live according to provisions of the Human Rights Convention. And there's a difference in terms of how the equality provisions have been implemented in the UK, in Britain as compared to Northern Ireland, and in the UK as compared to Ireland. And as I mentioned, under the directive in Europe, the provisions apply to employment. In the UK, they've broadened that out and it applies pretty much everywhere. But there's a difference in Northern Ireland, and in Ireland itself is different again.
Mm-hmm.
And so you need to look at that, because you need to find the provisions that apply in that private television context.
It's a public broadcaster.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
Barbara, do you want to say something about, margin of appreciation, because under the convention, one of the efficiency protocols now going to be written into the preamble that the states have margin of appreciation to determine what's best for citizens given the social conditions at the time. So the margin of appreciation is going to be emphasised. So as Barbara says, I think it's better to look at the equality law that exists rather than think about it in terms of a European convention.
Actually, when the last speaker was talking, it was just an interesting thought that occurred to me about the interpretation of, I can't remember what in Germany, so that, like,
the word
state
used.
Make,
yes,
yeah. The state can
yeah.
make an argument that it was
yeah.
culturally important, for example.
Yeah.
But actually, when you go back to our independence, or the proclamation of the Republic was actually signed in a vegetarian restaurant. But it's been written out of history because people just don't sort of want to go there. But they're like kind of snippets of very, very interesting. George Bernard Shaw was a noted vegetarian and stuff like that, or writers as well. And often you'll find when there's been an independence battle, people are cross-sectional in their approaches. They're interested in feminism and they're also interested in animal rights. So just a thought. Thanks.
Okay, thank you.